All right, guys. Well, welcome to the Forge. For those of you guys who are new, sorry, I'm moving this. Just so you know, it's right here. Is this someone's finger cast? All right. Well, I'm going to put that right there. Right here. Well, I'm excited to be back. It's been a couple of weeks since we've been here. I think 3 weeks. Last week, we had a week of prayer. The week before that, we had Christmas. We had between Christmas and New Year's, so we didn't have youth group, which was like the only time in the entire year where we canceled. It hurt to cancel. I was like, oh, this doesn't feel right. Also, another thing that didn't feel right was New Year's. How many had like a great New Year's? All right, listen. So the year before, we had an all-nighter. All right, like we had, yeah, it was awesome. We had like a section where we played video games. We watched movies at night. We had breakfast in the morning. We had like a cereal bar, like a cereal buffet type thing. We played grog till like 3 o'clock in the morning. Anyways, it was awesome. All right, this year I spent it in my room and I was kind of like, this is lame. I need to have another all-nighter. And so I'm, like, contemplating doing something next year. I have to run it by Wendy. That's why I'm not making eye contact with her right now. But we'll see. We'll see what happens next year. So I'm really excited for that. Speaking of grog, the 27th of January, I promised you guys, I told you guys that I was going to do one in January. We're going to have a grog night. At the very end of January, all right? It's going to be dark. It's going to be awesome. So we're going to play grog for about like 3 hours. Some people look confused. Who does not know what grog is? Okay, that's probably why you're confused. All right, real quick. Grog is a game that we play here at the Forge. It's a vicious game. It's a very competitive game. Some people break toes. It happens. It's the name of the game. So we haven't had any lost teeth or anything like that yet, but it's a very difficult game. And so you have two grog monsters. You have two grog monsters, and there's two levels. There's this floor and then the bottom floor, okay? Both grogs got to stay together. Everything's dark, by the way. We bring out, like, black lights. We're going to get more this year. So, anyways, everything's dark. Downstairs is, like, dark. There's black lights everywhere, dark black paint everywhere. And there's two grogs, they have to stay together, and it's kind of like freeze tag. Every person they tag has to freeze, but free people can unfreeze people. Does that make sense? So the point is, you have two people tagging everyone upstairs, and then they run downstairs and tag everyone. And if they tag everyone before the people can find a flashlight that's been disassembled into three different pieces and put it back together and then flashes it on the grog, they win. If they tag everyone before that happens, then the grogs win. All right? It's crazy. There's a lot of running around. And maybe, I don't know, this year, we usually leave all the chairs here. So it's like insane. Yeah. So anyways, it's going to be a good time. January 27th. It's a Friday night. We're going to play grog for 3 hours. If you don't like grog, come get a good workout. Pretend it's a workout. You'll lose some weight. So really quickly, tonight, I'm really excited tonight because, again, I haven't preached in a while. But I'm really excited because tonight I'm gonna be sharing some of my heart about the Forge. How many here love the Forge? It is life. No, I love the Forge. The Forge means a lot to me. I love the name the Forge. It just sounds like rugged. It sounds like, you know, manly. Sorry, ladies. It's not really a feminine name. But anyways, it just sounds tough. You know, there's something about the Forge that I really like, the name. And we're working on building the community that we have here. I really do believe that the Forge is like a family. Like, you guys are like family to me. Everyone said, aw. Aw. No, seriously, you guys are like a family to me. And I think that's part of why New Year's felt so weird. I was, like, away from not only my family, I was away from Wendy, but I was away from, like, you guys. And it felt, like, I felt empty. You know, you ever drive around and you're just kind of like, I feel empty. It's true. But then I had to leave because I had to FaceTime Wendy. Anyways, long story short, I felt empty, okay? I felt incomplete. So, but I really believe that the Forge is like family. I believe that the Forge is a community of people that has come together and we're striving to, we're striving to be what God has called us to be. We're striving to be the person that God has intended for us to be. And I've said this before in some of my sermons, but that human beings are the only ones who don't live up to the potential that God has for them, right? Like, what I mean by that is that dogs act like dogs, right? Like, that's what they do. Like cats act like cats. I hate cats, by the way. Amen. Sorry for you cat lovers. But humans are the only one that were created to be kind to one another, that were created for a purpose, and are the only people that don't live up to the potential and the purpose that God had intended for them. And so I believe that the Forge is the remedy to that, is a community of people and a community of students that strives to be what God has called them to be. And for the next few sermons, for the next few Tuesdays, I'm going to be talking about what the Forge represents. What does this community, what are some of the qualities that this community has and will continue to embody long after you're gone and long after, hopefully, after I'm gone, that the Forge will continue to carry on these certain traits. Because I truly believe, and this may be a little, I don't want to say prideful is the wrong word, elitist maybe, but I believe that like there's no other youth group like the Forge. I don't know if that's wrong for me to think about. I just feel that way. I just do. Everywhere I go, I'm like, oh, I'm with the Forge. Like, obviously, I wouldn't be with any other youth group because I'm with the Forge. And I feel like the Forge is the best youth group out there. And there's something about the Forge that draws me to it. And so tonight, I want to talk about some of the things that make the Forge the Forge. All right? So if we can put on the first slide. We are the Forge. It's coming. Ignore the rainbow. Oh. It's not there? Jordan. It's not Jordan. He's on sound. Jordan. January 17th? No? Lookup file, We Are the Forge, maybe? Sorry, we're experiencing some technical difficulties. Okay, while they're doing that, it should be a file, We Are the Forge. While they're doing that, I need somebody who believes themselves to be, like, mentally strong and, like, physically strong. Like, the strongest. What? Like, I need somebody who believes they embody this characteristic. We are the Forge, right? I need somebody that embodies this characteristic. Who believes that they're just like, they're just not a quitter? Who here hates quitting? Okay, keep your hand raised, all right? If you believe, if it's going to be a physical activity, okay? It's going to take some toughness. So if you're not in, just put your hand down already. All right, listen. Who believes like they have perseverance inside of them, just welling up, like, you will not outwork me, okay? Who believes they have grit inside of them, all right? Jaina, all right, come on up, Jaina. I need a boy, a gentleman. I'll take David Rosina. David Rosina, come on up. Take one of these. How good are you guys at drinking seltzer water? No, I'm just kidding. You won't have to drink it. Yo, Don's like, I'll drink it. I am so thirsty. Whoa. Huh? All right, guys. Really quick. We're going to learn. These guys, you guys are going to learn the easy way. These guys are going to learn the hard way. All right? So, David Brazina, I thought you weren't a quitter. All right, so we've asked some of the grittiest students that we have. We've asked some of the most perseverant, some of the toughest students. You guys believe you're tough? Okay, that does not sound convincing. Yeah, I don't know. Oh, my gosh, maybe. All right, so this is what you're going to do. You're going to hold this Schweppes, okay, sparkling seltzer water out like this, okay? And we're going to see who's going to hold it out the longest. Who do you think will win? Between me, David and Jaina. Okay? I'm literally going to preach like this, okay? I'm going to preach, huh? Whoever quits first. So I'm going to preach like this, okay? The entire sermon, all right? Like this. We have Dalton over there. He's like, I want to try. So, all right, you guys ready? We're gonna, look at these guys. That's what I love about these guys right here. You guys ready? All right, hold on. Let me get a drink of water. I'm a little thirsty. All right, ready? All right, 1, 2, 3, go. All right, so I want to talk today out of Romans 5, verse 3 and 4, all right? If you guys could turn to your Bibles, turn to your phones there. By the way, by a show of hands, how many people think that they, you have to keep, make sure that it's straight, okay? Going down, disqualification, okay? We're not going to get disqualified here, right? Everybody wave to the camera. Wave to the camera. Your arm tired already? No? Okay. Some psychological warfare going on. I like it. All right, so by a show of hands, how many think Jaina's going to take it home? How many think David Brezina? Mr. Brezina. Okay. And you guys don't have to vote for me because I believe in me. That's all I need. So, anyways, I want you guys to turn to Romans 5, chapter 3, verse 4. I'm going to talk about perseverance today. I want to talk about a quality that I think will set our youth group, The Forge, aside from other youth groups. Oh, sorry, guys. Hey. Okay. What? No, we're not drinking this. Don't think about it. All right, listen, we're going to talk about perseverance today. The first thing that I want to talk about is I want to give you three things that perseverance is not. Three things that perseverance is not, okay? The first thing is perseverance is not denial. Persevering through something difficult, okay, has nothing to do with pretending like it doesn't hurt. Does it hurt? Yeah, it burns. It burns. Does it burn? Oh, yeah. It burns. Listen, perseverance is not about pretending that it doesn't hurt. It's not about pretending that, what? My arm is straight. What are you guys talking about? I mean, not like, you can do this if you want, but you can't bring it below your shoulder, okay? Whoa, disqualification. So listen, the first thing is, it's getting hot in here right now. Well, not like this. All right, so the first thing is that perseverance is not about denial. It's not about pretending that it doesn't hurt, that it doesn't burn. All right, sounds good. Can you guys give it up for Jaina? All right, so perseverance is not about denial. Listen, Jaina, did it burn? It burned, right? The second thing that perseverance is not. Perseverance. My arm's shaking. Perseverance is not. It's not normal, all right? Listen, perseverance is not normal. There is a innate reaction that you have, just like pain, right? Whenever something hurts, whenever something feels painful, like right now, okay? It's like your body's telling you to quit. Your mind is telling you, listen, you want to give up. It's getting really hot in here. Holy cow! Woo! What? Who did? Literally, I can't feel my arm. Okay, so. Woo! My arm is like dead right now. But listen, the first thing is that perseverance is not about denying things. Listen, there's a lot of people that will tell you that perseverance is about pretending like you're not going through something difficult. Anyone ever gone through, let me get a little serious real quick. Anyone ever gone through something difficult? Pushing through, persevering is not pretending like this isn't hard. It's not pretending like you don't need help. It's not pretending that you're tougher than Superman himself, okay? It's not that. It's accepting their reality, but pushing past it no matter what. It's realizing, hey, you know what? This is difficult. This is hard, but I'm going to continue no matter what the obstacle is, because I believe the goal to be better and worth the suffering, or worth the current amount of pain that I'm in. As you can see, I'm running out of breath a little bit. Woo! Okay. Second thing is that perseverance is not normal. Perseverance is not a normal quality that you will find in people. It's not something that people will normally want to do. Like, when you meet athletes, okay, and they're working really hard. Man, it's really hard to think as well. I didn't realize that. Quitting is the normal thing. Giving up is the normal reaction to when you have something difficult happening in your life. Persevering, moving through, putting one foot in front of the other is not a normal reaction to life. It's not a normal reaction to hard things. The most people in general want to take the easy path because it's easier. The third thing that persevering isn't is that persevering isn't popular. Listen, quitting is probably one of the most popular things that exists on the planet, right? Like, you see all the time, people start things and they quit, they start things and they quit, they start things and they quit. It takes somebody of a different caliber, somebody of a different mentality and different character to continue even when it doesn't feel good, right? Anyone, like, I love motivation. Anyone like watching motivational videos, right? You're just like, oh my gosh, I want to take over the world right now. You're like, I'm going to be a millionaire, you know? Like, I'm going to be Bill Gates, or I'm going to continue, and I'm going to be a beast, or, like, you know, I'm going to be the best basketball player in the world. And I'm like, no, I'm Hispanic and I'm 5'5", so yeah. No amount of motivational videos are going to help me, okay? But it's easy to start, it's easy to continue when things feel good and people are behind you and your arm isn't sore and you haven't been holding out this bottle for, like, I don't know how long. You did it again? Put it back in the other arm. Jeez. Oh, like, my arm is shaking so bad. Okay, so I forgot my thought. I'm starting to second guess if this is a good idea. So it's not popular. Continuing pressing on when things don't feel right, when things don't feel good, is not popular. There's a lot of things. Most of the things that the world promotes is like these like feel good things, right? There's not a lot of people who are telling you, guys, keep going when it isn't easy. Keep going when you don't feel like it. Keep going when things get hard. Again? Yes, you did. You guys are confusing me. I'm like confused. All right, no more switching. Don't move. Left hand. I've memorized it now. You're done. Oh, wait. That makes... No. You got to put it on the side. The last thing that I want to talk about is this. Is I want to say, why do hard things? If you guys could turn... I don't know if you guys can put it up there, but if you could put Romans 5, 3, and 4. It talks about rejoicing in suffering. Right? Rejoicing in the difficult parts of life. No one likes suffering. Like, it's not a fun thing. Like, right now, this is, like, not fun, right? If, like, somebody came up, he's like, rejoice! Have joy! Like, enjoy this moment! I'd be like, what's wrong with you? This is hard. This is difficult. David Brezina is trying to beat me. I can't let him. This is not fun. I don't know why he did this. So, the thing is, the scripture starts this. Not only this, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering works perseverance. And then perseverance proves character, and which character brings out hope. There's another translation. This is the web, I guess. But the ESV talks about perseverance produces character, and character produces hope. You see, what you don't realize is that in the midst of your suffering, that's where hope is found. Suffering produces perseverance. Oh my goodness, I'm like this close to quitting. This close. This is like the look at my arms like shaking. Oh. Woo. bro, come up here. There's another bottle right here. Listen. Listen, shh, real quick, guys. Shh, holy cow. Come here. Hold the right one. Woo. Oh, goodness. Jesus, help me. Jesus. Woo. Okay, suffering. Going back. Yo, wait. Yo, give him 2 minutes, all right? Oh, I think my shoulder might come out. Ugh. All right, David Brezina. Woo, I give. Good job, big guy. Randy wins. I realize I can't preach and continue, so I let my pride go. Now I can't use my arms. I'm like, ah. No, later. See, listen. The reason it might come as something that doesn't make sense to think about suffering producing hope, right? To think about suffering somehow in the midst of suffering, that the actual act of suffering, right, brings hope to a situation. But what we don't realize is that because suffering produces perseverance, right? Those little victories that you get in life. When you suffer and you persevere, right, and you overcome that thing, you realize that, hey, you know what? I'm capable of overcoming. Once you've overcome one thing, it gets a little easier to overcome the second thing. Once you've overcome the second thing, you realize, hey, I've done these two. I can do a third. And then so you overcome that thing. And then once you've overcome this and you persevere in the second, the first, the third, and the fourth, right, you're now developing character, which is a habit. Character is what you would normally react to a situation. And so now every time you're faced with adversity, you know what to do. You know that you need to rise to the challenge, you need to persevere. So now you have character being built every time that you have challenges come up, every time that you have a hurdle come up, every time that you have a difficult time, you already instinctively know because you've piled up on the little things, right? All these little victories have added up, and now your character is being produced. Your character is being polished and brought forth, right? And as your character is brought forth, you realize that there's something that's fueling you to continue. You realize when you find something that seems overwhelming to the majority of people, you're like, nah, I can do that. There's hope for me to do that. Why? Because I've done it 35 million times before. And yeah, it started off small, right? It was a little victory here. Maybe it was getting a B in a class that I wasn't good at. Or maybe it was making the varsity team, right? And I pressed through and I pushed through until I got it. Or maybe it was something different. But the little victories begin to add up. And as you develop perseverance as a habit, you get what we call character, right? It's a part of our character. There's many other things that make up our character, like integrity, honesty, courage, all these different things. But perseverance then becomes part of your character. Then you can't separate JC and perseverance. You can't separate David Brezina and perseverance. You just you go as far as to say, no, David Brezina is a persevering person. No, Jaina is somebody who perseveres. You can no longer separate them. And so that when Jaina or David Brezina, anyone that has a character that is defined by perseverance, they meet another obstacle, they have what we call hope. Listen, and tonight you might find yourself in a situation, you're like, man, JC, my arms like is shaking. That's how difficult it is right now. I'm suffering. I want to tell you this. I want to give you some hope, and I want to tell you that the Forge is built on people who have never lost to any situation. This is what I mean by that. No matter how bad your life has been, you're still alive, which means you've overcome 100% of the challenges that you faced. If you were sitting here tonight, okay, that means that you have a record, all right, of 100. You have a perfect record of making it out alive in any situation. There's moments in life that perhaps you thought, man, I'm going to die, or I'm not going to make it, or there's no way I'm going to succeed, right? But you're sitting here tonight, and that in and of itself is proof that you've made it every single time, that all those moments you thought, man, this is the end of the world, this is the last day that I'm going to be alive, I'm just not going to make it, this is too hard, this is overwhelming, this is too difficult, I'm in it over my head. The fact that you're sitting here tonight is proof that you've overcome. It's proof that those things did not overtake you. And if you're sitting here tonight and you're like, man, JC, I'm finding myself in a really difficult situation. I'm finding myself in suffering. I'm finding myself in a situation where it's hard. It's painful. I'm being stretched, or my muscles are being challenged. There's a lot of pressure on me. I feel overwhelmed. I want to tell you, listen, that suffering, that situation that you find yourself into right now, whether it's family, whether it's grades, whether it's friendships, whether it's the future that's scaring you, whatever situation of suffering that you find yourself in, allow it to produce perseverance in you. Find yourself rejoicing in the situation that you find yourself in. Listen, we're not, again, perseverance is not about denial. It's not about pretending like everything is roses and gold or rainbows or whatever makes you happy. It's not about pretending like everything's perfect. It's not about going to school and never asking for anyone for any help or not being authentic and real and genuine. Persevering, it's about saying, yes, you know what, I'm going through a very difficult situation, but I'm going to continue because I know that this is going to produce perseverance in me. And if I can make perseverance a habit in my life, it will produce character that will endure. And once I have character like that, once I have that habit of persevering in the face of adversity, in the face of difficulty, in the face of challenges and problems, then I'm going to be a hope-filled person. A hope-filled person is someone who knows how to persevere in the midst of suffering. And they know that. If you ever meet somebody that's hopeful, if you ever meet somebody that has that just has like a crazy amount of like of belief that God's gonna come through, I'm telling you, they most likely have gone through a lot of things because they've built on little victories, and those victories have gotten bigger and bigger and bigger. Another point that I was thinking about as I was writing this, I was like, One of the sayings that kept coming to my mind was that we are the forge. This is us. This is our family. This is who we are. Look around, right? Look around. There's a lot of different people here, but we are family. If you come here tonight, if you come on a regular basis, he's like, yes, we're family. We're family. And here at the forge, we do hard things. We do difficult things. The majority of people run from challenges, but I want to raise a generation that doesn't run from challenges, that doesn't run for obstacles, but that says, I am willing to do hard things. I am willing to do difficult things and to muster perseverance and to make perseverance a habit so that character is built in me and I can be a hope-filled or a hopeful person for the future. You see, I was talking about this and I was writing this out and I was like, why do hard things? Like, why not take the easy road? Right? Like, that's a question that if I was a teenager, if JC was preaching this to me, I would say, why do the hard thing? Why not take it easy? Why not just cruise through life? Why do the hard thing? That does not sound appealing to me in any way. God bless you. I don't know who sneezed, but God bless you. You're being blessed all over. I want to say this. I want to say that what you overcome, what you are able to overcome will make you. And this is what I mean by that. One of my favorite stories in the Bible is David and Goliath, right? Anyone ever like that story? Like, when I read that story and I was in like in children's church and I was teaching and stuff, I'm just like, man, I want to raise up kids who just believe they can like slay any giant that steps up to them. You know, just like, whoa! Like, that's just what I envision in my mind. Like, I want to raise a generation of kids who are just like, I did the nunchucks. That's like not really a sling. Anyways, I'm into nunchucks, I guess. But I want to raise a generation of children and youth leaders and students who believe that giant slaying is a possibility. But see, listen, if David doesn't step up to the giant and slay the giant, David never becomes famous. David never becomes famous. The fact that he slayed the giant, the fact that he stepped up to the giant is really what got David known. You see, you can't become a giant slayer if you don't slay a giant. Does that make sense? You can't be known as a lion killer if you don't kill a lion. You can't be known as someone who does hard things. You can't be known as someone who has perseverance. You can't be known as someone who does these things and not actually do the things that you want to do. I used to go to school in Boston, and there was a saying that we'd always kind of throw around, and it was this: that everybody wants to be a beast. Everybody wants to be someone who, whether it's in sports or whether it's academics, they just want to be the best, right? Anyone ever heard that saying? You want to be a beast, right? I'm not crazy? All right, good. I'm not that old yet. But nobody wants to do beastly things. Nobody wants to put into practice. Nobody wants to do the hard things that are going to get us to the place where we can do amazing things for God. Nobody wants to persevere in the difficult times. And this is where all of this is coming to really tonight, for me, at least specifically. And it's this, is that God's been really challenging my heart, because a lot of youth groups focus on making sure that there's a lot of students that attend the youth groups. And they focus on making sure that they have the biggest youth group ever. But what I feel like is most important is the fact that when people graduate youth groups, the majority of people who graduate youth groups never go back to church and lose their faith in God. And I think part of that is because we're not teaching students how to persevere during difficult times. And sometimes, and I'm not saying always, but sometimes we have this idea that Christianity is going to be easy. We have this idea that Christianity is going to, like once we get saved, like all of our problems are just going to disappear. Like this. We have this idea that God is going to come in and just fix everything in that moment. And sometimes what God is saying, no, he's like, I've put you in this situation so that you can develop perseverance, so that you can make perseverance a habit and then develop character, and not only bring hope to every situation that you encounter after that, but so that you can be a hope for other people. You see, if one of you is able to overcome something, then there's somebody else that can look at you and say, hey, you know what? If that person was able to do that, then maybe I can too. If that individual was able to come out of that situation and make it out alive or make it out well, or they were able to overcome that specific obstacle, then you know what? Maybe I can do the same in my situation. That's one of the ways that we have character producing hope, not only in ourselves when we find ourselves in situations, but in other people who are watching us. We're called to be the light of the world, right? We're called to be an example everywhere that we go. And so when people watch us, they're going to be watching us and seeing how we face our challenges. I think one of the things that we need to focus on is pushing through the hard things, pushing through the hard seasons in life. I have a friend who I love dearly, and he always says this. He says, listen, there's four seasons in a year. One of them is bound to be difficult. Right? There's four seasons in a year. One of them is going to be hard. How many like winter? God bless you. Put your hands down. I've left Canada because I don't like the cold. I don't like the winter. I want to move to Australia or like Aruba or somewhere nice. But listen, no matter where you go, there's going to be difficult seasons. And in Christianity, you're going to have your difficult seasons. You're going to have seasons. Can I be real with you guys real quick? I have 15 minutes. I don't have that much time, but listen, there's going to be moments where you're going to doubt and you're going to be like, man, like, is any of this like real? Did I just make all of this stuff up in my own head? There's going to be moments where maybe you've gone to camps and there's moments where you feel like you're on a high, and then you're going to have moments where you feel so low that you feel like, man, like, am I even worth it? Does God really actually love me? You're going to have moments where you can't feel God. You're going to have moments where no matter how many times you come to church and no matter how many times you sit down in your favorite seat, you're going to have moments where you're going to say, man, I feel far from God. What do I do? My advice to you would be a Forge student and press on. Listen, do the hard thing. Read your word even when you don't feel like it. Get up early and pray even when you don't feel like it. Come to church even when you don't feel God, right? Because we're a society that lives by our feelings. Listen, do the hard things even when you don't feel it, even when it isn't easy. Learn to build perseverance inside of you. The majority of people in life, they treat life like it's like a sprint, right? They want to get rich quick. Everything's fast. Like, they want to get married tomorrow. Like, all you guys are like, no, not me. Maybe, kind of, sort of. Like, 2 years would be perfect. Everybody wants everything fast. Like, we just want things right now, right now, right now, right now. But good things take time. And I want to tell you that I stand here tonight as a youth pastor, right? Someone who believes deeply in God and who knows that God is the most important thing that you could ever, listen to me, the most important thing that you will ever, ever, ever have in your life. Most important thing by miles, okay? I know this because I've persevered through some of the difficult situations in my life. I've learned to persevere even when things didn't feel easy. Even when it was difficult to trust God in certain situations. I said, you know what? I feel like quitting, but I'm not. I feel like quitting, but I'm not. And I want to tell you that if you felt like quitting, welcome. All right? If you felt like quitting, welcome to the club. We've all at one point, and maybe we don't preach this enough. Maybe in Christianity, we aren't vulnerable enough to say, hey, you know what? I felt like quitting before. I felt like giving up sometimes. Not just on God, but perhaps life or whatever it may be. But I wanna encourage you that the Bible talks about if we stick things through in the midst of our suffering, God will provide hope, not only for ourselves, but for the people around us. I'm going to invite you to stand up real quick. I'm going to give you the last reason why we don't quit. I'm going to try not to get emotional. We don't quit because Jesus didn't quit. Jesus never quit on us. When I close my eyes and I think about the Garden of Gethsemane and I think of Jesus kneeling and asking the Lord and saying, God, if there's another way, please let this cup pass from me. Listen, Jesus didn't feel like going to the cross. There's no good feelings that were invoked when he started thinking about the fact that he was going to be nailed to a cross. One of the reasons that I want to challenge you to press through the difficult situations in your life is because the person that we follow, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, our mentor, our leader, our King, didn't quit. He came here. He had a mission, which was to redeem us, which was to buy us back, which was to pay the price that we could not pay. And he said, I'm going to fulfill that mission no matter what it takes. And I want to raise a generation that says, I'm going to see things through no matter what it takes. And when there's moments where I want to quit and I say, you know what, man, I've been going to church and I don't feel God. I say, persevere. You know what? I feel overwhelmed with school right now. Persevere. You know what? I just don't feel like I'm worth it right now. Persevere. You know what? It's reading the Bible is really hard. And you know what? Sometimes it's boring and sometimes I fall asleep. Persevere. You know, sometimes waking up is really difficult in the morning so I could pray. Persevere. Try again tomorrow. Wake up again tomorrow. Try again until you get it. You know, showing up to these events, JC, is really difficult for me. persevere. Or maybe your situation is more drastic. Maybe your situation is like what mine was when I was younger and I was a youth. Maybe you find yourself in a situation in the middle of a divorce. And you're like, man, I don't know how to handle this. Press into God and persevere until perseverance becomes a part of who you are, until it becomes part of your character. And your character brings hope to not only yourself and to the situations that you're going to encounter later on, but to those around you. I told you earlier that you're a light. People are drawn to you, and people will see how you face challenges, how you face obstacles, how you face the hurdles in your life. I don't know where you're at tonight, so I'm gonna invite you to close your eyes really quickly. I thrive on challenges, and perhaps this is not everyone here, but that's just how I work. I love challenging not only myself, but I love asking God to challenge me, to stretch me, to make me better. I've said this many times, I truly believe that the Forge is a community, but not only a community, but a family. And so I'm going to challenge you guys to do something that's hard. I know what it's for me, so I'm going to get a little vulnerable with you. I know what it is going to be for me. For me, it's going to be waking up at 5 o'clock in the morning so that I can have enough time to pray and do my devotions in a manner that I'm not rushing them. In a manner that I can say, you know what, God, we have all this time. Do what you will. Speak what you will into my life. That's going to be my hard thing. I don't know what your hard thing is going to be, but I pray that God right now would speak to you, would speak to your heart with everyone's eyes closed and heads bowed right now. Let God speak to you. God wants to develop some perseverance inside of you. God wants to develop perseverance inside of you until it becomes a habit and it becomes part of your character. God wants to build perseverance inside of you so that it becomes your character, so that you can bring hope wherever you go, so that you can be a hope-filled individual. Earlier I talked about why do hard things. Because if you don't know how to do hard things, you won't know how to handle some of the things that life throws at you. You won't know what to do when the enemy comes against you. You won't know how to persevere in prayer. You won't know how to persevere into the Word of God. You won't know how to press in to God's presence. You won't know. And I truly believe that that's one of the reasons when people graduate youth groups, they fall by the wayside, because they don't know how to persevere. It is not part of their character. We persevere because God persevered. We persevere because God persevered all the way to the cross. I'm going to give you a few moments so that God could just let you know what it is that He wants you to do. What it is that He wants to challenge you with. What it is what's that hard thing that you're like, man, you know what? This is just really, really hard. God wants you to persevere in it. And you know what? One day, for example, for me, tomorrow, I might not wake up at 5, but guess what? I'm going to try again on Thursday. And Friday, I might mess up, but guess what? I'm going to try again on Saturday and Sunday, and then Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, and I might mess up again. I'm going to get back up, and I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep trying. That's what perseverance is. Let's pray real quick. God, we come before you tonight, Lord. God, and I'm asking you that you would just instill perseverance inside each and every one of us, Lord. God, that you would make it a goal in this youth group to have students who know how to persevere, who know how to travail, God, in your presence, who know how to press in to your word, God, and into your presence, Lord. Who know, God, how to push past the feelings, God, of not feeling good, or perhaps it doesn't feel like something they want to do, Lord. God, I pray that you would just teach them to persevere past that, Lord. God, I pray that you would ingrain perseverance into their character, Lord. God, that they would not be the type of people who are afraid of doing hard things, who are not afraid of obstacles or mountains that come before them. But God, that would rejoice in them, Lord God, because they know that it's another opportunity to be perseverant. It's another opportunity to develop character. It's another opportunity to bring hope to the world, Lord, and to those around them. God, I pray that the retention rate in this youth group would be vastly different than any other place, Lord. Not for our glory, but for your glory, Lord. God, I pray, God, not only in this youth group, but I pray that in the time that they're in this youth group, that they would learn perseverance, God, and that they would learn how to persevere outside of this youth group. That they would learn to cling to you, Lord Jesus. That they would learn to be part of the vine, God. That they would learn, God, how to stay close to you, Lord. How to stay in your presence, Lord God, and to not give up so easily, Lord. And God, finally, I just pray, God, for every student who finds himself in a place of suffering, Lord. Who perhaps does not feel like continuing. Who perhaps feels like they can't make it. Who perhaps feels overwhelmed, Lord. God, it is you who gives us the strength to persevere. It says in Philippians, God, that we can do all things, Lord. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, Lord. It is you who gives us the strength to continue. And so, Lord, I just pray, God, for everyone who's here, God, I pray that they would persevere in drawing closer to you, God, and that you would give them the strength to overcome, Lord, whatever situations they find themselves in. God, have your way in each and every one of these students, Lord. I pray that you would make us a youth group that is marked by perseverance, Lord. I pray that we would have a quality about every single youth member in this place, Lord. That they would all be persevering. That they would all be people, God, who don't know how to give up, Lord. And God, who have made a commitment to you, God, the most important commitment, God. And who would never, ever, God, give up that commitment. I pray in Jesus' mighty name, and everyone said, amen and amen.